Let's look at Matthew chapter 6. We're continuing our series, Righteousness in Daily Life, or Righteousness in Everyday Life. And a couple of weeks ago, we finished, we glanced at this passage, Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 to 18, and we talked about the fact that there are rewards. Three different times, Jesus says in this passage that they have their reward. When you do these things, there's giving, there's praying, there's fasting. He says when they do these things the wrong way, they get their reward. But he said, your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And we talked about the fact that as Christians, we need to be focused on the right reward, right? The right reward. Would you like for someone to give you $100 now or $1,000 at the end of this month? There are people that would take $100 now, right? Their need dictates it. Maybe their greed dictates it. There's a lot of reasons people would do that. But what Jesus is pointing us in the direction of is saying we can't get caught up on the short-term rewards because God wants to give us bigger rewards for the glory of God. Okay? And so we talked about rewards. This week we're going to break this down a little bit more and a little bit more practical and actually look at the three things that Jesus talked about. Again, these three things were basically the three parts of righteousness for a Jewish person. So when Jesus said, when you do these things, not if you do these things, but when you do these things, that you need to do them the correct way for the correct reward. All right, so let's just pick this up. Matthew chapter 6. We're going to read all 18 verses today. And I believe we have it on the screen. You can follow along in your Bibles. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. By the way, if you like different translations, other than the King James Version, that's totally fine. Just make sure it's a translation that makes God's Word say what God's Word says, right? I found that the New Living Translation is one that does that for me, and so that's what I use. And if you ever have any questions about that or anything, feel free to talk to me. And if you're looking for a translation that's easy to read, I encourage you to check it out, New Living Translation. Matthew chapter 6, verse 1. Jesus says, watch out. Don't do your good deeds publicly to be admired by others, for you will lose the reward from your Father in heaven. When you give to someone in need, don't do as the hypocrites do, blowing trumpets in the synagogues and streets to call attention to their acts of charity. I tell you the truth, they have received all the reward they will ever get. But when you give to someone in need, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. Give your gifts in private, and your Father who sees everything will reward you. And when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites who love to pray publicly on street corners and in the synagogues where everyone can see them. I tell you the truth. That is all the reward they will ever get. But when you pray, go away by yourself, shut the door behind you, and pray to your Father in private. Then your Father who sees everything will reward you. And when you pray, don't babble on and on as people of other religions do. They think their prayers are answered merely by repeating their words again and again. Don't be like them, for your Father knows exactly what you need before you ask him. Pray like this. Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. May your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need, and forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us. And don't let us yield to temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. If you forgive those who sin against your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive your sins. And when you fast, don't make it obvious, as the hypocrites do. For they try to look miserable and disheveled, so people will admire them for their fasting. I tell you the truth. That is the only reward they will ever get. But when you fast, comb your hair and wash your face. Then no one will notice you are fasting except your Father who sees what you do in private. And your Father who sees everything will reward you. Amen. And amen. May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for these timeless words that we are looking into today. Thank you for the word of God that strengthens us and encourages us and compels us to live differently. Thank you for this manifesto, if you will, of righteousness, God, that you've given us and showed us how to live out. You've blessed us so much. Thank you for not leaving us alone, not just giving us directions on how to live, but you give us the power to live out your righteousness. And so, Lord, help us to understand what you meant, not just what you said. Help us to apply it to our lives. May we be, as James says, to be hearers or to be doers of your word and not just hearers. And then, Lord, make us different so that we can reach people in the world who look at our lives and see our good works and also desire to glorify our Father who is in heaven. Thank you for seeing us. Thank you for knowing us. And thank you for helping us. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. Jesus says, don't be like them. Don't be like them. I've entitled this message, How to Not. There's a lot of things that you learn how to do in life, right? A lot of things that you know how to do. But the only reason you and I know how to do some of these things is because we've discovered how not to do some of them. You know what I'm talking about? I think I've told you the story before of my first audition as being a good, handy husband and being a plumber, right? Emmanuel's a plumber back there. He knows how to do these things. I don't. But we got a house, and we decided that we needed to do some plumbing. There was our faucet was leaking in the bathtub upstairs on the second story of the house. And the problem with the house is that there were only shutoffs in the basement. The only place you could shut the water off was in the basement. And so, and obviously, to shut the water off, you had to do that in order to get the plumbing repaired. And so I shut the water off and did all those things. But then it came to sweating the copper. Those of you know, I heard a chuckle. Anybody with me? Sweating copper is definitely a part of the fall, right? It's something, there's a curse against human beings, at least for me. So I ran upstairs, I took the thing apart, I put everything together, I sweated the copper, didn't do it right, didn't know what I was doing, turned the water on, water's going everywhere, run back downstairs, all the way to the basement, shut it off, go back upstairs, dry everything out, do it again, run back downstairs, turn the water back on, run back upstairs, water's going everywhere. Shut it back off. 3 days, I think it was, right? My wife remembers, 15 years, I think. 3 days. I lost 15 pounds running up and down those steps. I mean, water everywhere. I was so frustrated. So frustrated. And I don't know, I think it was just dumb luck or the Lord was just having mercy on me or something. I don't know what it was. But finally, it actually held and everything didn't, water didn't go everywhere and I was okay. And my wife let me sleep in the bed again. No. The problem with that situation is that I wasn't a plumber. And I should have stopped pretending that I was. Right? I tried. I bought all the tools. That's my MO, right? If I don't know how to do something, I just buy every tool that you need to do that, and that makes me feel like I know how to do it. Anybody with me? Yeah, exactly. But we still don't know how to do it. Or if we do learn how to do it, we only learn how to do it for a second, and then after a while, we forget how to do it. But we have all the tools to do it. Just don't know how to do it. But I wasn't a plumber. I was fooling myself. I was trying to put a plumber hat on when it didn't fit my head. Jesus says, watch out, don't be like them. In fact, Jesus used a very strong word that we often throw around in our society today. He used the word hypocrites. Don't be like the hypocrites. The word hypocrite actually comes from a Greek word that almost says exactly the same word, hypocrites, and it simply means play acting. Play acting. You know, drama. More literally, it means to put a mask on your face, right? And you put a mask on like this. Hopefully it's a smiley guy, not the sad guy. But we are good at being this way, and Jesus knew that, right? Human nature is good at simply hiding what's really going on in our heart, hiding what's really going on in our life. And so we are very easily drawn into doing things, quote-unquote, the right things for the wrong reason, and we're simply oftentimes being a hypocrite, all right? Hypocrites are people that say they're doing this for this reason, but they're really doing it for another reason. All right? They say they love Jesus, but really Jesus doesn't have any of their time throughout the rest of the week. Only on Sunday mornings, only on Christmas and Easter, only on... But Jesus wants more than that, doesn't he? How many of you are glad for the day when Jesus helped you take the mask off? You know what I'm talking about? You can just say, Jesus, you know me anyway. You know my faults. You know my mess-ups, my hang-ups, my habits, my frustrations, all this stuff. And when we take that off, we can then get down to where the rubber meets the road and start living out what we're seeing here, all right? So Jesus is simply saying to us this morning as we look at these things, brothers and sisters, if you're going to follow him, take the mask off, right? Take the mask off. Let's look at what he talked about. Jesus talked about, or showed, he showed us rather, how not to do some things. If we're going to follow Jesus, we have to learn to not do things like we've always done them. To the Jewish person Jesus was talking to, giving or almsgiving was the same as righteousness, right? So when you talk to a Jew about righteousness, actually in Hebrew, it's the same word. Can you believe that? If you say, are you righteous, that also means, do you give? Righteousness and almsgiving, same word, same Hebrew word. How serious they took it to give. Now, in our society, it's very much optional in many ways, right? We don't have people, I don't have anybody calling me typically during the week and saying, Pastor, can I give to your church? Now, I have people calling the church and saying, hey, we need this and we need that and we need the other thing. But in their culture, it was different because if you wanted to be viewed as righteous, that means you gave more. And you didn't just give more, you gave more openly so people could see you giving more, and therefore they thought you were more righteous. And that's why Jesus didn't say, if you give, but he said, when you give, because he was speaking to people who were very religious, and they were very much accustomed to giving because that was just part of their culture. Because of this, it just seemed natural to give more and more openly if you wanted to be perceived as more and more religious. So, Jesus starts off with this business of giving. He shows us how not to give. How not to give. Have you ever been in a church or in a building when there's plaques all over everything? I didn't say plaque. I said plaques, right? Those little silver or bronze or gold-looking little things, and everywhere you look, there's plaques on everything. Do you know why that is? What's that? Because people gave. Now, I don't think that every person that gives and they put a plaque on something that they give, for instance, you know, Andy buys a baptismal, so we put Andy's name on the baptismal. You know, you can give in honor, you can give in memory of, and there's nothing wrong with that. I'm not throwing stones at that. But if there's some people, and I've met them, and maybe you've met them, that give only when they can be recognized for their giving. I will give if I put my name on this, or if you put my name on this. That's why you go to oftentimes, you go to campuses or places, and you'll say, you'll see, this is John R. W. Smith Chapel or whatever. Oftentimes, it's because people want to give and have their name tied to it. Jesus shows us that we are not to give that way. Christians, if we're going to follow Jesus, our giving must be different, right? Let's look at what Jesus says we're not to do in our giving. We're not to do. First of all, let me just make a quick note here. Jesus tells us that we are to make personal investments in people, right? Look at what he says there in verse 2. He says, when you give to someone in need, this is before he says, don't do this or don't do as the hypocrites do. When you give to someone in need, Jesus tells us that our giving can't just be an institutional exercise, right? As believers, we can't say, God, I'm going to outsource my giving just to the church and we'll let them figure out what to do with it. But Jesus is assuming that his hearers are using what God's given them to also invest personally into people. Now, I encourage you, as a believer in Jesus Christ, to reach into people's lives. And when you do that, it's going to cost you, right? It's going to cost you time. It's going to cost you energy. It might cost you a few extra dollars in groceries to make an extra meal, to invite somebody over in Jesus' name. But make sure we are taking the time to make personal investments in people's lives. What have you done for somebody in the name of Jesus outside of your giving into the church? What have you done for somebody? Now, we all know that there's people standing on the street corner. They have signs. Many of them will work for food. Some of them are not telling the truth. Some of them are not honest. Some of them are making a whole lot of money at people's generosity, at the expense of people's generosity. However, there are people that are in need. And most of the time, the people that are really in need are not going to ask you for anything. You ever notice that? What if the fellow at work, maybe you work beside somebody and you find out that, you know, his family member died and you have to go out of town for an unexpected funeral? What if that's a need and you know that they're struggling financially? What if a gas card, maybe in his locker at work or something like that, would that be a blessing? You say, well, no one will ever know that I did it. Exactly. Exactly. Jesus assumes that we're going to be making personal investments in people's lives, someone in need, not just some organization in need. We ought to give. to God's work, but we also need to be giving personally into people's lives. Secondly, Jesus teaches us to not give by not making our gifts about the givers. Now, again, this is a cultural thing. When you read the Bible, you're talking about people blowing trumpets. Would that be weird or what? Anybody bring your trumpet before we pass the offering plates in a little while? That'd be strange. We don't do that here, but in this culture, it was normal. In this culture, it was very much a part of their culture. People would let others know, hey, I'm about to give my offering. I'm about to give my tithe to God's work. And they would literally blow trumpets. In fact, I read about one interesting custom in some of the Middle Eastern countries. Years ago, water would become very, very scarce, and so therefore very, very valuable. And so what would happen oftentimes, someone would go to the water guy, whoever he was, Mr. Water Guy, and they would say, hey, I'm going to give you this amount of money, and I want you to give this amount of water for this amount of money. I want you to go into the marketplace and yell out, anybody who's thirsty, come. Now, who would be most thirsty in a place like that? People without money. And so the poor people would come, and when they would start gathering around, the guy who gave the money would then walk behind the guy giving out the water and say, hey, bless me, I'm the guy who gave the money for the water for you. Obviously, that kind of took away the whole point of his generosity. You see, he gave with himself in mind rather than with the gift receiver in mind. Jesus says, don't blow trumpets. You know, no one needs to know what you give. Don't make the gifts about the giver. Little g giver, not him. Make it about him, not you, not me, all right? So when you give, don't blow trumpets like the hypocrites do. I notice there's only one small little I in the word give. Just a little one. God uses us, doesn't he? Does he need us? God doesn't need anything, including us. But he uses us if we will allow him to. But we need to not make it about us. Jesus says that we're not to give in a way that lets everybody know that it's us. He says these words, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. Anybody ever read that and you're thinking, what in the world was he talking about? Don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. See, I'm not dyslexic. I can do that. I figured that out. It took me a while. In other words, what Jesus is saying is that you don't have to let people around you know what you give or when you give or how you give. Right? The greatest blessing from giving comes when you give and nobody even knows about it. Right? When you give because you feel God prompted your heart and you say, yes, Lord, I want to obey you. Yes, Lord, I want to encourage somebody. Yes, Lord, I know that there's money needed for this particular thing and I'm going to give to that and I don't need anybody to know that I gave. One of my favorite things as a pastor is when I hear news of somebody, Wayne's our treasurer, and people have given anonymously. Say, well, somebody gave that when we were in an elders meeting. I was like, wow, somebody gave anonymously. I love that. I love that. Why? Because I know they're giving for the right reason, more than likely. Not exclusively, but more than likely. When we give, we need to keep the secret between me and God, right? One of the things I wish we would do, and maybe we will in the future, and the cool thing about text to give is because it facilitates this, is that when you do it that way, or we have a box for an offering in the back of the church or somewhere, it doesn't, you know, there's no offering plate coming by you. Now, we'll just be honest for a second. I grew up in church from the time I was 11. Many of you did as well. How many of you ever felt pressure to put something in the offering plate because it was the offering plate and it was time to take the offering, even though you didn't want to give? You can be honest. I've been there. You know, you feel weird. You're like, I hope nobody's looking at me right now. I'm just pass it real quick. You know, or just, you know, scratch your head, act like you don't even see the guy holding the offering plate. That's normal. That's normal, right? We don't want to be embarrassed. But what Jesus is teaching us is that that shouldn't be the reason we give anyway, right? It doesn't count. Now, some of you are like, okay, by the way, I'm not putting anything in the offering plate when it comes by. No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying don't do it for the wrong reason because you missed the blessing. You get a reward, but it's nothing compared to the reward of our Father who sees everything secretly, all right? Keep the secret. Don't let your left hand know what your right hand's doing. I've been in church services where they took the offering and it was like an auction. You know what I'm talking about? Who's going to give $500 over here and who's going to give $1,000 over here? And then I'm like, well, did you not read this? How do we get to that point? How do we get to that point? Lord, help us. I better go on. Get off of my soapbox there. No. Let's give for the right reason. Let's not give for the wrong reason. Let's make a personal investment in people. Let's not make it about us and let's just keep it secret, right? No one needs to know what you give. In fact, if someone cares what you give, it shows a whole lot about them, because we're giving to his kingdom, right? His people, his glory. Jesus taught us how not to pray. This is going to get good. Taught us how not to pray. Jesus tells us that we are not to pray like this. He says, when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites who love to pray publicly on street corners and in the synagogues where everyone can see them. By the way, synagogues would be the equivalent of church, okay? They're trying to pray publicly on street corners and in the synagogues where everyone can see them. I tell you the truth, that it is all the reward they will ever get. But when you pray, go away by yourself, shut the door behind you, and pray to your Father in private. Then your Father, who sees everything, will reward you. When you pray, don't babble on and on as people of other religions do. They think that their prayers are answered merely by repeating their words again and again. Don't be like them, for your Father knows exactly what you need before you ask him. Jesus teaches us not to pray by teaching us that we should not pray to be seen by people, rather to be heard by God, right? Not pray to be seen. Interestingly enough, he didn't say that these people pray this way so that they can be heard. He says these people pray this way so they can be seen or perceived as holy or perceived as righteous or perceived as really devout. We are not to pray to be seen by people, but rather to be heard by God. Secondly, Jesus says that we are not to pray and feel like we must use big words to be heard by God. I love this translation because it uses the word babble. Have you ever heard anybody pray like that? They're babbling. They pray for 5 minutes and you only recognize 2 or 3 seconds of substantive prayer coming out of their mouth. Why? Because they're praying because they know all the prayer words. Maybe I should just download that. I saw an article this week, it was really funny, about Christianese, right? You know what Christianese is? It's the language that gets created in the church, and we know all these punch words and all these interesting terms that nobody outside of the church knows anything about. And so when they come, they're like, well, I don't understand what's going on. What are you talking about? You know, why are you doing these things? Jesus is saying, be real when you pray, right? Don't babble. Don't just use big words because you heard somebody else use a big word. I know it's an interesting phenomenon that happens, but I know of a guy. He's a pastor, and his entire demeanor, his voice, the volume of his voice, everything about him changes when he prays. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, it's like he turns into Paul Harvey. Remember Paul Harvey on the radio or something? It's like he turns into some totally different guy while he's praying. Then when he prays, he shuts it back off and he's back to normal again. Sometimes I just want to unplug that switch or shut that switch off and say, who are you really? Who are you when you're all alone? A friend of mine, Daniel Henderson, says something like this. He says, who a man is when he prays is who he really is. When you pray by yourself, when there's no one around, and when you're on your knees or driving down the road or standing out in the beautiful field or watching the sunrise drinking a cup of coffee, who you are in that moment when you have communion with God is who you really are. So it doesn't matter the big words. It doesn't matter the things that you say. I've heard people tell me, actually just this past week, someone said, you know, I don't know how people pray like that. I said, pray like what? Well, it seems like they get talking and words just come. And, you know, I don't know about you, but if you grew up in church, you've heard hundreds of people pray. And sometimes it's easy to kind of go through the grocery store and grab things and put it in your prayer cart, and so you start praying like everybody else. I want to encourage you to do something. Same thing I want God to do for me from time to time. Just dump that stuff out and talk to God like you talk to God. Right? That's what prayer is about. That's what it's about. And when you start talking to God like you talk to God, after a while you'll find that it's not so hard to spend so much time in prayer because you actually believe that he's hearing you. Because you know that it's coming from your heart and not somebody else's vocabulary. Don't feel like you must use big words to be heard by a big God. Don't babble. There is no need to speak to God in a different shade of English than you normally speak to other human beings in the society you live in. Did you get that? Let me read that again. There's no need to speak to God in any other shade of English than you normally speak to other human beings in. He doesn't hear you more because you used old English. All right? If you add est to the end of all of your words, he doesn't hear you any more than if you just say the word. Amen? Amen. Lord, help us. Because That's how we begin praying mindlessly. When we start using words for the sake of words, we don't really mean it. We begin praying mindlessly, and we're just saying stuff because that's what we've heard, but really we're not connecting with God. Our connection's broken because it's about us. It's not about him. Number three, Jesus taught us how to not pray by teaching us that we don't need to feel like we must pray long prayers in order to be heard by God, right? He says they babble on and on and on and on and on. Isn't that monotonous? And on. You know what I'm talking about? Where, you know, maybe you're praying in a group and you pray and someone else prays and someone else prays, and then there's that person. They just take like 45 minutes to finish their prayer. Jesus says, you're not getting heard because you pray longer, right? Maybe you just need to have more prayer time personally so you don't got to do this publicly. I don't know. I heard someone say that after 1 minute in prayer, you know, if you're in a group of people and you're praying for 1 minute, then people are praying with you. After you reach the 1 minute mark and you're into 2 minutes, people are praying for you. And if you go over 3 minutes, people are praying against you. Shut them up. We don't get extra credit for having long prayers. Right? I mean, what would happen if you spoke to your spouse the same way you speak to God? You'd get nothing done, right? If you have to say all these flowery words in order to get their attention, no, you've got their attention. You're their spouse. Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. We have God's attention, right? We don't need to beg him to listen to us. He already knows where we are. He knows we're needy people, right? He sees our bank account before we come and ask him for something. He knows who we are. He knows what we need. Don't feel like we must pray long prayers. Now, does that mean that we won't pray very long? No. No. Where were the New Testament believers at in the book of Acts when the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost? Where were they? In the upper room. They were together. They were in one accord. And I got a feeling that prayer was taking place, right? Prayer was happening. Does that mean it was just a now I lay me down to sleep prayer? No. It means they were interceding. They were connecting with God, with each other on the behalf of what God was doing. They were obeying Jesus. He says, go there and tarry. He didn't say, go there and play video games until the Holy Spirit comes. What do you think he meant by that? Go there and pray. Worship, connect, do life together. All right? Don't feel like we have to pray long, but we will pray longer when we connect with a better connection. Right? It's kind of like working with computers. I'm not a computer guy, but it's kind of like, remember back when you had the dial-up connection? You know what I'm talking about? And it takes 10 minutes for a page to come up. There's only so much work you can get done when you're having that connection. But think of what can happen if you had a high-speed fiber optic connection that we have today. How much more work gets done now? It's because the connection's different, right? So drop off the stuff that doesn't need to be said. I love Amy Carmichael. If you've never read about Amy Carmichael, she was an amazing woman. I encourage you, get some of her books, some of her writings. I've not read much of her material, but what I have read, it's phenomenal how God used this woman. And here's what she said about prayer. I read this in a book last year about her life, and this really, really impacted me, and I hope that it impacts you and it's helpful in your prayer life as well. Here it goes. Amy Carmichael's Principles for Prayer. First of all, she says, we don't need to explain to our Father things that are known to him. So if you take out of your prayer time with God, when you're telling him what he already knows, how long would your prayer be? Anybody feel guilty about that? You've been there? When I read that, I look at my prayer and I think, God, I'm sometimes telling you stuff you already know. Now, that doesn't mean that we shouldn't remind God, right? Doesn't mean that we can't ever say, God, now you promised me this, or you. There's nothing wrong with that. But when we spend our time to make our prayers longer because we're reminding God about things that he already knows, we're wasting our time. He already knows that, right? He already knows that. Secondly, she says, we don't need to press him as if we had to deal with an unwilling God. Jesus is making reference to the people that are heathens, and he says that they babble on and on and on and think that because of their many words and their much speaking that their gods hear them. In some ways, I believe he was referring back even to Mount Carmel. Remember that story, the book of Elijah? He was on top of the mountain, and then the prophets of Baal were there. And so Elijah let them have the first stab at it to get fire to fall from heaven. The Bible says they're praying, and they're yelling, they're cutting themselves, they're doing all of these things trying to get their God to hear, and Elijah's over here laughing at them. Hey guys, is he on a vacation? Is he sleeping? How come he's not answering you? And they kept doing it on and on and on, and finally they wore themselves out. Jesus said, don't wear yourself out in prayer trying to say other stuff. He says, we have a God who is willing to give us what we need. Do you view him that way? Do you view God as a miserly old person who doesn't want to give you anything, only give you the bare necessities to keep you alive? That's not who he is. God is a generous God. God is a loving God. God is a caring God. If you're a believer, he wants to bless you, right? Jesus said, if you being evil or you being human, you want to do these things, how much more does your Father want to give you? Good gifts. The Holy Spirit in another place. God wants to give us things. So when we pray, we need to approach God that way. God, you promised that you would provide for me, and so I'm just going to trust you to do that, right? I'm not going to beg you to do that. I'm not going to beg you as if you're stingy and you don't want to give me anything, but I'm going to pray and seek your face and trust that you are a God who is not unwilling to give what we need. Thirdly, Amy Carmichael says that we need to have the principle of prayer that we don't need to suggest to him, and this is a big one, we don't need to suggest to him what to do, for he himself knows what to do. Have you read your grocery list to God lately? God, on the 15th, I want you to do this, and then this is coming up, and I need you to do that, and such is going to happen, and so God, I need you to do it this way, and if you could make it not rain, that would be great, and that's what we do. But what's the point of praying if we're going to tell God what he's supposed to do? Prayer ought to be a picture of submission of ours to say, God, here's what I see, and whatever you want to do is good with me, right? However you want to do it, however you want to fix this, however you want to bring this about, I don't even have all the answers. You ever wear yourself out trying to get all the answers? I know I have. When you pray, don't tell God what he needs to do. Tell God that you're willing to do whatever he tells you to do. I love the picture there in the book of John, Jesus' first miracle at the wedding of Cana in Galilee. Remember that story? Jesus is young, probably about 30 years old, and he goes to the wedding, and they run out of wine, and for some reason, I'm not sure exactly why, Mary comes to him, his mother comes and says, Jesus, they're out of wine. I don't know if Jesus is a normal person to go to in that situation or what, but up to that point, it doesn't seem like he's done any miracles. So she says, Jesus, we're out of wine, and Jesus says, that's not my problem. And then Mary does something fascinating because she turns to the servants after Jesus basically blows her off and says, hey, it's not my problem. It's not my monkey, not my show, right? And she says to the servants, whatever he says to do, you do it. Whatever he says to do, do it. Now, I'm sure the servants were probably in panic mode, right? Because if there's no wine for the party and all of this thing, you know, the marriage celebration, somebody's in trouble. Somebody's in trouble. But Mary recognized that Jesus would do what Jesus needed to do, and he knew exactly how to do it, and he didn't need her help, right? She didn't say, Jesus, tell these guys to fill water pots and go make it turn it into wine. No, she says, do whatever he says to do. Our prayer ought to be directed to a God who we can trust to do what needs to be done. He knows what needs to be done. We try to fix it, we try to connive, we try to work things out, and then we try to get his blessing upon it. But what we need to do is just take our hands off and say, God, I don't know how to do this. That's why I'm praying, and that's why I need you to come through. I'm not going to tell you how to do it. You're going to be disappointed, just as many other believers have over the years, over the centuries, been disappointed when God doesn't answer your prayer. But the problem is, your prayer was about what you wanted rather than about what he wanted to do. Lord, help us to not suggest to him what to do. Let's not spend our precious time, and trust me, in America, there's never been a time when people pray less than now. You believe that? There's never been a time when people, Christians, are praying less than now. If you were to add up what people listen to the radio, watch television, they're on social media, the internet, add up all of that time, I'm sure it would be less than a tenth, and I'm being very generous, less than a tenth of that time is given to prayer. And so I'm saying prayer time is precious, even in our lives, church. So let's not waste our time, our precious prayer time, reminding God, dictating to God, explaining things to God that he already knows. Let's just go to him as a loving father and say, God, I need you, right? Let's just seek his face. So Jesus taught us how not to pray. When you pray, do it to be seen by people. Don't feel like you have to say big words, right? Don't babble on and on. Don't feel like you have to pray long prayers to be heard by God. He's here, okay? You don't have to talk him into coming where you are. He's already here. And then thirdly, Jesus taught us, he taught his disciples how not to fast. Now, fasting is a fascinating thing. Those of you, I'm not going to have you raise your hand, but many of us have fasted. Many of us have no idea what fasting is. Many of us, maybe you've tried it and it didn't work out very well for you. And so you just stopped it. Let me remind you of something. Jesus was talking to people, and I believe he's talking to us. He says, not if you fast, but when you fast. Now, how many people here today know that fasting changes you in ways that nothing else does? You know that? Fasting will change you in ways that nothing else does. And so Jesus was talking to people who would fast, but again, they were fasting for the wrong reasons. They were fasting because they were looked upon as really righteous people if they fasted, you know, and they fasted certain days of the week and let everybody else know about it. And as we'll see in a moment, they walked around really disheveled and made sure everybody in the world knew they were fasting. But the point is, Jesus tells us when we fast. If you haven't fasted, I want to challenge you to do something. This week, I want you to fast for one meal, right? If you do fast already, I want to challenge you to do something else. I want to challenge you to fast an extra meal or an extra day, depending on what you're fasting. It's not just food, but food sure does have a way of getting to the core of who we are, doesn't it? All right, it does for me. Maybe it's not you. When I'm hungry, I think differently. Do you? My wife says, amen. Yeah, I'm hungry. I'm like a bear. I got to eat. You know, kids get on your nerves easier. But when we fast, we're focused, right? When I'm really hungry, you know what I'm focused on? I'm focused on getting done what I'm getting done so that I can get some food. But when we fast, it also helps to take away all the other distractions in our life so we can focus on God, right? Focus on him. And so if you don't fast or you haven't fasted, I just want to challenge you. Just skip a meal and don't be like I did early in my Christian walk. I was really generous with God. I was really spiritual, all right? I would fast, but I would fast breakfast because I didn't eat breakfast, right? All right, God, I'm going to throw this one your way because, you know, I'm really spiritual. But I really wasn't doing anything. I was just doing what I normally do. Only I'm putting God's stamp on it. But what about supper? What about lunch? What about ice cream? All right, I'm in the brush. I better keep going. I'm going to get in trouble in there. There's some things that we can just give up. What is fasting? Fasting is simply giving up something dear to us so that it takes away the distractions of our life so we can focus in on God and what he's saying. All right, that's really what it means. And food is just a great way to start that. Maybe it's Facebook. Maybe it's your hobby. Maybe it's something that you do every day and it's just part of your routine, but it's not necessary and it takes a bunch of your time and you don't have time to pray. Fasting is a great way to get us focused on God. Jesus emulated it. Down through the Bible, many, many, many people emulated fasting for us. Moses, 40 days. Jesus, 40 days. It happened, and God uses it to change people, and he uses it to change lives. All right, I believe that he'll use it to change a church, and I believe that God wants to use it in our church here. Jesus says, when you fast, here's how not to do it. He says, don't make it obvious. Don't make it obvious, all right? If you walk around with I fasted today t-shirt on, it kind of killed the point. You know what I mean? It just didn't, you know, no brownie points there. Don't make it obvious. Don't walk around looking like you're dying. That's what Jesus is saying. You know, I don't have to let anybody know. He goes on to say, you know, don't try to look miserable. Later on, he says, wash your face and comb your hair. Did you know that? That's scripture, moms. If your kids are having a problem doing that, read that verse. I think it's verse 17. Where did it go? Wash your face. Yeah, but then when you fast, comb your hair and wash your face. Okay, so that's scripture. Tell your kids, comb your hair and wash your face. Jesus said those words, and you're not telling a lie. But he says, don't do these things. Don't try to make it obvious. Don't try to suffer out loud. Right? You don't need to let everybody know. You don't need to let everybody know. Because when you do that, he says you lose your reward. You lose your reward. Your big reward. People know. They might applaud you. But always be willing to trade the applause of men for the smile of your Father in heaven, right? Be willing to do that. He sees. There's not one thing you will ever give up for Jesus that will go unnoticed by Jesus. You believe that? There's not one thing you will ever give up. That's why it's worth it. That's why when Jesus says something crazy in our society, in our minds, we think it's crazy when he says, if any man wants to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. That's why that's not crazy, because from this point on, everything I do for him, he knows, and he keeps a whole lot better count than I could anyway, right? That's why it's not a loss. It's not a loss to follow Jesus. It's not a deduction from our life. It's really an investment in God. And trust me, he pays his bills. He provides for us. He gives us what we want, what we need, rather, in this life, but he will also provide for us eternal life. So, you say, how does this work in my life? What does that look like? Well, what it looks like is if you're not giving, you need to start giving. And give like Jesus says to give, and don't give like Jesus says not to give, and you will find rewards that you never found before. If you're not praying, you need to start praying. When you pray, is there a time when you seek God's face? You know, and I'm not talking about just the I'm in a jam prayer, right? I'm not talking about the Jesus take the wheel prayer, right? We were good at that, aren't we? Corrie Ten Boom said something like this. She says, prayer ought to be our steering wheel, not our spare tire. It's true, isn't it? We make it our spare tire. Only in emergencies. If I'm in a pinch, Jesus, help me. But what if prayer was a part of our life? I'll tell you one thing. It wouldn't be quite so long from Sunday to Sunday in your spiritual life. It wouldn't be quite so lonely when you walk out these doors, but you'll have a closer relationship to Christ than you've ever had before. Make it a daily part of your life. When you pray, and when you do this, just make it between you and Jesus. And the blessings between you and Jesus are a whole lot better than the blessings between you and any other person on the face of this earth. All right? He says, when you fast, what does this look like in daily life? If you're not fasting, fast. Fast because Christ assumes that you're going to, and fast because it's good for you. It gets you closer to God, and you experience him in ways that you never would otherwise. All right? And I believe that when we do this, church, when we start giving like we need to give, praying like we need to pray, fasting like we need to fast, Jesus will reward us not just individually, personally, and away from everybody else's view, but also he will begin blessing us as a church, and we will begin to experience God bringing more and more and more people that are hungry for the gospel, hungry for Christ, into this place. That's my prayer, right? If we're going to be a healthy church, we got to give, we got to pray, we got to fast, because that's what Jesus taught us to do, right? Amen. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for this passage. Thank you so much for what it means to our lives. Help us to apply it. Help us to not just leave this place and go right back into the same rut that we were in before. But Lord, help us to try something new. And I pray that you would help us to hear your voice and be called to the next level in our walk with you. To the next things, the new things that you have for us. I praise you, and I thank you for your word that shows us ourselves and shows us you. And so change us, we pray, so that we can be changed in order to change the world around us for your kingdom and for your glory's sake.